Okay, so had any, let's get started. Let me drop the agenda to the chat. Okay, so welcome everyone to the Merge Implementer School number 5. Let me turn off my video first. Okay, so yeah, we will try to finish this call like 5 minutes before the top of the hour to let people have a break before the next call. So yeah, I think we can manage to do this. And let's start with implementation updates. Does anybody wants to, I know that there is no active implementation at the moment after Ionism. Most of client developers are busy with the hard forks. But anyway, does anybody have anything to share regarding the implementation update? Okay, so I would like to highlight a couple of things. First one is there is a PR to Geth repository, PR by Gary. I'll just drop it here. And yeah, this PR contains some a bunch of changes and what matters like a lot in this moment of time is the transition logic implemented on the Catalyst side. So we can like, if we have like, when we have this logic implemented on the beacon chain client side, so we can do some testing locally and do some probably semi-public devnets and this stuff. Also, there is a work happening on the state sync as well. And this is what I would like to ask a Geth team about. Does anybody can speak on the progress regarding that? What is happening with the state sync implementation?
Not really. Peter was working on this, but yeah, he got sick and I guess he got distracted. I'll kick him about this specific topic. Otherwise, yeah, there's the PR by Gary that got tested during Ionism and works. Right, so it should be integrated soon, but yeah, regarding sync, I'll get back to you.
Cool, thank you so much, Guillaume. Yeah, sync is not like the top priority at the moment. The top one is the transition process, but it will be a number one priority pretty soon. Okay, if there is nothing else to implementation updates, we can move on to the research updates. And here we have the PR with the transition process. Yeah, this is like, let's say this is the implementation of advanced transition process where we compute the transition total difficulty at the moment of merge fork. Instead of predefining this transition total difficulty at the client deployment moment of time. So I'd like to encourage everyone to look into this PR. And yeah, hopefully it will be merged like in a week from now. So it will make sense to start implementing it on the beacon chain side. There is a bit of debates on how in particular this logic, this total difficulty should be computed, but in general, I think there is the rough consensus around the approach. Yep. Does anybody want to ask anything here or add to this topic, to the transition process stuff?
Did we want to talk about how the difficulty offset is calculated yet, or is that for later in the call?
Yeah, I think we may talk about it here. Yeah, and continue offline. So, okay. So the general idea is to compute it at the moment of when merge logic is enabled and the code on the beacon chain is transitioned into the merge fork. Here we have like two ways of computing the difficulty, the transition total difficulty. First of all, we are computing it based on the ETH1 data. We take the block that the recent ETH1 data in the state contains, and take its total difficulty, and adding some offset to it, like the offset will be roughly about a week worth of difficulty contributed to the network. And here we are, we have this number and we are waiting for it to start to kick off the transition process. And the discussion is happening around how to compute this value properly. So one of the ways is to just take some number and pre-configure it within the client code deployment, like which will happen like probably a month before the computation actually take place. Do it this way. The other one is to take the difficulty of this particular block that is referred by the ETH1 data in the state and multiply it by the number of blocks that we are expecting to happen in the next week. These are two ways. Like the first one is, to my observation, is like more conservative, and we can use our expert use the information our expert opinion and defining what will be the lowest safe or what will be the safe total difficulty offset after the merge fork which we would like to put in this period of time to the transition process. The other one is to take the difficulty of the network and use it to estimate this period of time. So the one is like more conservative. The other one is like more predictable. We also want not to have the merge in the weekend or some kind of stuff, and to make it like as close to 1 week as we can. Vitalik, do you want to add anything here?
Yeah, interesting. I mean, I actually consider the second one to be more conservative, but the difference is that for the offset, so this is like the amount, the total difficulty that's allowed to happen between the ETH1 block and like the terminal proof of work block, so the last proof of work block before the chain becomes embedded. Like it's going to get computed based on some formula. And the question is like, I think there's two questions, right? So the first question is that formula going to be a formula that like we as core developers use and to come up with a number, and then we put the number in the client at the time that we distribute the clients to people? And the second question is then like, what formula is that? Right, so like a simple, like I think in both cases, we would expect the formula to be something like, take what we think the difficulty is or is going to be at that time, and then multiply it by the number of blocks in 1 week. So the issue that I see with like pre-calculating it is basically that if you pre-calculate it and you just like put the result as a number into client code, then that like you're relying on information that's like at least 3 weeks older than the actual fork. And so like between that time and the fork, lots of things could happen, right? Like the difficulty could go up by a factor of two, it could go down by a factor of two, depending on prices, things could get fairly volatile. So like there are like basically making a decision earlier when you have less information is something that just intuitively seems to have like more risks when making the decision by just putting it in protocol so the formula executes like at exactly the merge time is more up to date. I guess like the best arguments that I've seen, like heard or thought of against my proposal, which is the calculate the offset in real time, it happens if miners manage to coordinate and like they all or most of them turn their miners off for like 2 days before that particular point of calculation. And you know, they make the difficulty go down by a factor. Or I guess, no, what they would want to do is they would want to bring in a huge amount of extra hardware temporarily. And well, they could do either one, right? They could push the remaining difficulty either down or up and then either make the merge happen very quickly or make it happen slowly. So it's more like having a better estimate versus being more vulnerable to attacks. I guess that's where I see the trade-off as being so far. There are also hybrid options, right? So like one hybrid option that I suggested, for example, is the option of making it be the minimum of some fixed number, which we could calculate at client deployment time and the difficulty of these one block multiplied by a week. But like at the same time, I don't think I care extremely strongly about the difference between those three.
I think like taking the minimal difficulty at the like point of deployment, right? That was what was suggested. Yeah, I think it could also be it also prone to the same issues like difficulty at the point of merge logic enabling.
Right. Well, the attack, if we have the minimum of like pre-calculated difficulty and difficulty in real time, then the attack's worse. But on the thing that seems much harder, like how do you even manage to just like quickly bring in like 200% more hash power?
Yeah, and another way, like another way of doing this minimalist safe difficulty is to put some constant, right? Why I'm thinking about the make it constant because we can estimate the entire hash power that could be put onto the network. And we can get something out of it instead of relying on the network condition on the network in the moment of time.
Right. I guess my view is that like we can do that, but if we have a formula does that, why not just put that formula into the code and so we get the formula and more updated information.
Okay, so does anybody want
to? No.
I'm sorry.
You've been breaking up, Vitalik.
Yeah,
you keep cutting in and out.
The most recent like if for someone gets for an process for me.
You sound like a computer from like the 60s.
Am I still okay now?
We can hear you now, yes.
Yeah, okay. So I'll just say more advanced formula before coming up with
the same issues.
Yeah, actually, we can't hear you, Tarek.
Okay, I'll just type.
Walk up a taller building.
Yeah. Okay, so does anybody want to add anything to the discussion?
And just a quick point of clarification. If the miners hypothetically all turned off for 2 days, that would move the merge and then turn back on. That would move the merge closer, or that would push the merge further away?
No, it will move the merge closer because we take the lower difficulty as an estimation. Yep.
Right, if you dynamically calculate at that point.
Yep. Right.
That's why my point about having like minimally safe difficulty. So it's we can't take the value. We can take like the value from the network at this moment in time, but it can be lower than some safe merging. So if we see like this goes down, the hash rate goes down significantly. We have a cap. We have a lower cap. We have a cap on the lower boundary that we take for estimation, just to avoid this kind of stuff when the difficulty, when the hash rate goes down significantly and then it goes up significantly, right. But we already set with this computed total difficulty threshold.
So the one problem with that, and maybe this is an acceptable problem, is that it's possible, hard to say, but possible, that the total hash rate will decrease as the merge approaches, as people try to sell off their hardware before the rush of selling off their hardware happens. So it's possible we will legitimately see a crash in the hash rate that does not return before the merge. And so if we go with that, I think we just need to accept that it's possible that we could end up having a very delayed merge because we hit a minimum and we hit that minimum value. And then, you know, now we have to wait for that difficulty to be hit, which may take a while because half the hash power sold off all their hardware. Sold off all their hardware 2 weeks in advance or whatever.
Which would happen if we set an offset anyway. Like if we set an offset, like a fixed offset that was based off of what we thought the hash power was at that point, then it would also do a delay.
Can we provide rewards for mining for a few months after the merge? However strange it sounds, can we like delay the time when it stops being profitable to do the hash rate and just execute something of like that chain that just provides the rewards for mining blocks?
We talked about this a lot. It is an option that would kind of realign incentives a little bit for certain problems. I think most people seem to agree at the time that the complexity of implementing that just wasn't worth the gain. And maybe we can reevaluate that, but at the time, at least, that was the primary argument. It's just a lot of complexity, and we get a little bit of benefit.
I mean, if it gets delayed by like more than a week, then it will also be easy to, during that time, coordinate, like to make it about a week again, right?
Yeah. I mean, if you needed to cut new releases that do --- transition difficulty and then put a number in, you could.
Well, or you could just make it generally like a parameter that's easy to tune and then just say at some point, hey guys, it's changed. Here's like what you input.
So I worry a little bit about a command line parameter that is a consensus rule that we expect people to change, just because like for miners, we assume, or at least for mining pool, we assume they actually know how to do that. I do worry that we want Ethereum to be accessible to the average person, and the average person who just double clicks on Nethermind probably does not know how to configure it via the command line. We can teach them, but that could end up being a pretty big undertaking. So if possible, it'd be nice if we can avoid requiring command line arguments to have a merge be successful.
I mean, to be clear, this would only be like a fallback if the worst happens, basically.
Yeah, that's true. Like, if as long as we believe the chance of the fallback being is needed is low, then I guess that's, you know, better to have the safety net there than not. It'd just be really nice if we can try to avoid depending too much on that, like as being a, oh, this will just work fine. Like, I think it should be more like, we have a fallback, it'll probably lead to a bunch of fires and things not working great and things breaking, but it's better than the alternative.
I mean, we anyway probably need like a fallback for kind of a forced merge, where you just agree on a block in case miners actually do an attack, right?
Probably
so I feel idea, like the attacks actually have, the fallbacks actually have great advantages in that they really like make it very unattractive to attack when you can tell people, hey guys, like if you do it, it's not gonna work.
Right, but yeah, it can't recover. We should understand that this way it will not recover the attack outcome. It will just accelerate the merge.
I mean, in that case, if you're going to have a parameter, it actually makes sense to make it the other way around, that you can't run the software without the parameter so that it's pre-tested. Otherwise, it will be like one of those things that people think will never get used. They don't bother to learn it. And then if it's needed, nobody will know how to do it.
Yeah, I agree with the sentiment that it's, if we make them, that guarantees that we don't have a fork, or decrease the chance of having a fork to a very small number. What I worry about is we might drive away those users that we're trying to, like we keep talking about stateless and all these things to attract novice users to running Ethereum themselves rather than relying on Ethereum and whatnot. And adding command line parameters is a great way to drive away, you know, the mom and pop user that we're kind of at the same time trying to encourage to run the software. And I know we're not doing great at getting the mom pop to run the software, but it'd be nice if we can avoid introducing even more hurdles for them.
Okay. Well, one thing here is that even if we compute the total difficulty like on the fly, we might want to have a mechanism to check this, the computed value. And one of the ways is to communicate the transitional difficulty of chain and to allow for at least validators and users to check that this is what they get on their local nodes, just to avoid any kind of failures with regard to wrong computation. Vitalik, do I understand you correctly, your statement that if we need to hard code whatever parameter in this formula, then we better fall back to the hard coded transition total difficulty that we have been discussed before?
In the formula.
Sorry.
I don't know. I don't really feel like I have super strong.
Okay. Let's just continue flying. So I encourage everyone to take a look and visit this PR. This is the important piece of. Of the merge,
right?
And the tricky one. We can actually hear you now.
Okay. I don't know. I don't really feel like I have very strong opinions on this. I feel like he just wants to move as long as. Users have command line options that they can just like use as a that it should be fine for one.
Cool. Shall we take it to the issue? Continue the conversation there and hone in on something.
Yep. So let's move on. Any other research updates? Okay, so one thing I want to give a heads up about consensus API. We'll definitely get back to this discussion again, but I'd like to prepare some document or this kind of stuff. I've been thinking about it in my spare time, and I'm leaning towards that we that the duplex communication channel is almost a requirement for this kind of communication. Yeah, we can use WebSockets, yeah, but let's just speak about it later. There's probably like a new type of message that we'd like to introduce into the communication protocol. So this kind of things will happen soon, I guess, after transition process PR is merged. Okay, so let's move to the discussions. Yep.
Really quick question on the two-way communication, the duplex socket. Does it need to be trusted by both sides, or is it still only one side owns the trust of that relationship?
You mean like, so yeah, the execution client trusts what has been sent from the consensus, right? But
yep.
I was also thinking about the restore after failures when the clients exchange messages, like what is the the head block at the moment do they haven't probably like beacon chain client will have to rewind some blocks and feed them back to the execution client. And yeah, so yeah, I don't know, probably requires some trust.
Okay.
As well. So we'll see. And it also depends on the use case, I guess. If it's like the service that provides the execution client stuff, then yeah, you don't want to trust service, or service don't want to trust to your consensus node, consensus client. So yep, need to think about it more. But it's definitely a bit more complicated than we have than what we have now. Let's move to discussions. There is a short, proposal by Justin to remove the execution payload header. Justin, do you want to speak about it? Do we have Justin here?
Thank you, love it.
Sorry, what?
I think you left.
Okay, so yeah.
Yeah, I think definitely the current discussion point is interesting in that this in statelessness all of a sudden becomes a much larger object, which I don't know if there's much value in keeping in state, although the most recent header you're probably keeping around. The most recent block you're probably keeping around anyway. But yeah, I don't know. I don't feel super strongly about it, but my gut would be to just put the header in there.
Yep. I understand the sentiment that there is already a lot of block-related structures. We have block header, block body, block, and the PO block header, proof work block header, and proof work block body. And we have execution payload and execution payload header. So the idea is to simplify it a bit and have just execution payload, but it implies that the transactions of recent block will be stored in the state. So we use the execution payload, we put it inside of the state, and it depends. Yep, do we want to to make this trade-off between simplicity of implementation and the spec and additional space in the state. So currently it's like 1.5 megabytes at max. So it's really negligible. By the way, what is the current state size, the beacon state?
It's dominated by the validators, right? So it should just be 150 bytes times the validator count. So times about 300,000, so it should get us to about 45 megabytes or so.
And then I think everything that's not the validators is it should be a couple megabytes.
Yeah, right. So it's like 100 megabytes, if I'm not mistaken, like at the moment. And we'll like five times larger if we have.
Right, but it also the validator set does not change a lot state to state. And so if you're deduplicating and you're keeping like say an epoch worth of states in some sort of tree structure, then you don't actually have to duplicate the validator set a ton. Whereas this entire block payload changes every block. And so that would be like something like it's in statelessness, like a 10, potentially 10 megabyte, 5 megabyte diff on each one. Of these like tree back states. And so all of a sudden you actually have a lot more in memory that you have to store. I can write that in the issue.
Right. But like, are we even going to try to make a beacon block execution stateless though?
No. This is Justin suggesting putting the entirety of the execution payload in state at each slot. The most recent rather than some sort of like header.
What you get from that?
You were breaking up, but what you get out of that is you don't have another object, which is an execution payload header, and you potentially have value by having transactions readily available. But I think that the way the state diffs and the way that you want state in memory, I think is going to probably not make that a good idea.
So can I add something here?
Sure.
So the execution payload, if we embed the transactions in the state, then you can do these types of transitions that take more than a block. And so if we do end up with some kind of MFE protection, then I think we need this kind of look back to the previous block, or at least this could help. But then regarding state size, I'm against, as in it would just add a lot of noise through the beacon state format itself, which would change every block and would basically just hurt and duplicate a lot of block information.
I think, especially if Justin's not here, we can just take this to the issue.
Right. Yeah, so look into this PR, comment on it, let's discuss and revisit it later. Okay, let's move on to the last point of the agenda. Right, not last, but yeah, anyway. Difficulty of code and randomness after the merge. There are two aspects here. First one is the difficulty, which is like easier to work with. The other one is the block hash. Let's start from difficulty one. And if we have a time, we can discuss the block hash as well. Okay, so the difficulty opcode currently returns the difficulty. Obviously, we have a constant. We have already a constant for this for the difficulty field in the execution block for after the merge. But since it's a constant, and some of existing applications already use difficulty opcode for in their source of randomness, Yeah, usually it's like difficulty plus timestamp plus probably block hash, but probably some applications use just difficulty. And by setting this parameter to just a constant value will break the logic of these applications. And what we can do here, there are two ways. First one, which is desirable, is to rename difficulty opcode, because it's going to be obsolete soon, to some kind of to the rundown or random, and pass the most recent rundown makes from the we can change side to the EVM, but this is more a long-term solution because it requires the change on the EVM layer, on the EVM level, which we are trying to avoid for initial merge. And for initial merge, we can do the following. We can just borrow a few bytes, like 8 bytes, first 8 bytes of rundown mix, and put them as the difficulty parameter into a block. And yep, that's how can EVM access this difficulty as a random, as some random value, not as a block difficulty after the merge. So here we are, here we have like the dilemma, which way to go. So my preference, actually, yeah, I prefer the simplicity and this, the latter solution, the second one with the difficulty field set to the rundown, to the value derived from rundown. But probably there are some other opinions on that. Let's discuss, let's think about.
Why do we care about people who didn't follow the advice of every security expert in Ethereum since 2016 that said, do not use difficulty for randomness?
That's a good question. Do we need to take care about those people? The same we can address to the block cache usage, right?
Yeah, it's basically the same argument. People are using block cache for randomness. Like every single security expert says, do not do these things. It's blog posts, Solidity, like everywhere. There's warning signs. Don't use these for randomness. And there are still people, of course, who don't listen. We can't stop them.
Right.
But I don't know if we need to protect them and keep them functioning. Like, especially if it's going to cause us work and pain.
Right, but okay. So yeah, the default option is just do nothing and set difficulty to 0 or to 1 and to some constant value for the third option here. Why we would, I don't know, we want to give the application, we want to give the ability to have a real randomness, moderately strong randomness, which we have on the consensus layer to the application layer. Right, so we have this rundown stuff. We want to provide it at some point in time in the EVM, and we can, as I've said, we can use the difficulty opcode, just rename it to rundown, and this like this first step. I don't know if we use this interim solution. So this is going to be the first step towards this way. That's just my thoughts.
Yeah, although I don't feel like we necessarily need to protect applications that use it poorly, it's not a bad compromise, I think, to rename it and insert something that is pretty random into it. I mean,
That would
break fewer things. Yeah. Go on.
Sorry, would the rename actually be a consensus change, or is that like just like we start calling it something different in docs?
I think you start calling it something different in docs and you put a new source of the value, which is the rando.
Gotcha. I mean, from an engineering standpoint, if that's like low cost or easy, I think that's fine. Like my main concern is I just don't want to add extra engineering just to protect those people. But if it's like, hey, we want to give them randomness and this is a good way to do it, and it's very little engineering effort, then it seems like a good fit.
Okay, so if we follow this way that you've just described, so then we do nothing at the merge. We use constant for difficulty. And then when like EVM changes are coming after the merge, we implement this scheme with renaming difficulty to rundown.
Right. I guess the funny part there is that you end up with a not insignificant stretch of time where everything does break. So all the lotteries, all the ERC-20 horse races do break, and then they unbreak.
Just for like 3 or 4 months. Just don't go to the tracks for 3 or 4 months, and they'll be okay.
So I really don't want to break anything, actually.
Yeah. I mean, from that perspective, if you have like the stepwise, it's totally broken. I think it's actually maybe better to break it once and don't unbreak it. Like this is deprecated. This is now returns to value one, and then give a new opcode. Just because the unintended consequences of having essentially lotteries break and then unbreak is harder to reason about than just them breaking.
Yeah, it would be nice if we could reuse opcodes though. Like we do have a finite set, and we can extend that theoretically by doing 2-byte opcodes. And we aren't running out yet. Like it's not like we've got three left or anything, but it'd be nice if we've got a thing that we're not using anymore to be able to reuse that in a way.
Yeah, okay.
And again
just nice having specialized opcodes that are just like push the number zero and push the number one, like it's not the worst. It reminds me of how WireScrutle required incoming transactions to send one way so they could use the value opcode to push number one, and that saved them 500 gas. Like, if we make difficulties on the number one and people just abuse it for that, then, you know, why not?
All my
but then,
push,
are we saying please use... Yeah. At that point, we need to promise not to change it from being the value one. Or are we all of a sudden saying, don't use this for value one?
That's a good question. Because there are people who do exactly that. Like they push zero as the first opcode, so that way they can dupe it, because it's cheaper to dupe it than it is to push zero. Right. And so if you can save, you know, another three gas by using difficulty to get zero or one or whatever, they will do that. The type of people that do that, that being said, the type of people that do that are almost exclusively bot authors, and their bots, you know, they come and go like weekly. So like they're not the worst people to break, because they can upgrade very easily. Like they switch contracts regularly. That being said, I'd rather have it return invalid. Now we're talking about an EVM change. We're going to do an EVM change. Why not just throw a rando in there?
Yeah, sorry, Michael, what was your last message?
The ideal solution, if we're going to have it be like break it and we want to reuse the opcode, would be to have it throw or be an invalid opcode during that interim time. But if we're going to do that, I believe that requires an EVM change. And if we're going to do an EVM change with the merge, we might as well put rando in there.
Yeah, right. See.
It's like our options are put rando in for difficulty, or have difficulty now become the push one opcode.
Right. Okay. Yeah, so. Anything else regarding difficulty? Okay, so the block hash stuff. This is just going to be broken. In terms of the randomness source, it will not be protected by the proof of work after the merge anymore. And we can't do here anything, because the block hash has its original semantics, and the semantics might be used by existing applications. Yeah, so we can't change it to anything. Yeah, I just want to, if anybody hears us here, hears this recording, and they have the application that depends on the either difficulty or the block hash as a source of randomness, just reach us out in ETH R&D or any other channel so we can discuss it and see potential ways around it.
Anyone know the answer to the Proto's question?
I do think that it's important to like not leave these issues open for too long, because that just like risks causing delays because of the spec not being done. But
does anyone know what click does with the difficulty opcode?
It's hard coded to 2 for an intent block and
one for out of turn. Like difficulty is actually used as difficulty.
Okay. Oh, that's right. This just came up, right?
Yeah, but quick is not used in production.
That's true.
And how about other EVM chains? I mean, we share all the tooling, so we better just try and align it.
What do you mean?
I mean, Ethereum is not the only chain with EVM. So if we mirror other proof of stake or proof of authority chains with this opcode, that might just be best.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Good question. Okay. So, okay. Yeah, worth checking, definitely. If we're done with the randomness and difficulty, we can go to the open discussions. If there are no open discussions, so we can wrap up and jump on the other call in 10 minutes.
So what is the plan with block hash? Like would the block hash opcode just return the hash of the execution block still?
Yes.
Okay. No, that's fine.
Yeah, that's the default plan. Just do nothing.
And if we have like,
sorry.
Yeah, and at some point in the future, we are going to have to break all of the old proofs, I think, because at some point we would want to retire RLP and change the format over to like some new SSZ-based thing, and probably at the same time add some more proof verification pre-compounds that are more future-proof. But I guess, yeah, that problem does not have to be solved for the merge.
Right, right.
Before we end this discussion, can someone give a very quick overview of why it's hard, like a two-sentence reason as to why it's hard to get Randao into that spot at the merge?
To get Randao into the block hash spot, like, or
in difficulty, like, sorry.
Right, right. So basically why we have to like break and unbreak instead of just immediately saying if a block is an embedded block,
yeah.
Randao. I don't know.
Like in my head, I'm just imagining the consensus client simply sends over to the execution client when it asks it to build a block. It says, hey, and use this for the difficulty. And the execution client then just builds a block with that as a difficulty.
Right. If we are talking about just set the execution block's difficulty field to the something derived from Randao, it's is easier. Then take the whole Randao mix, give it to the execution client, and the execution client will embed it into the EVM and expose it via difficulty of code.
Just a quick question. When you say something derived from Randao, like why not the Randao? Why do we need to do the deriving?
I mean, derived like difficulty field is obviously 60-bit long, and yeah.
I guess like from a long-term perspective, I don't really think it makes sense to have an opcode that returns like the last 8 bytes of the Randao, because that would just be redundant with the future opcode that we're going to need anyway that returns the entire Randao.
Yeah, that's a fair point. So the complexity is just to do anything with EVM at the point of merge. That's it.
Isn't the difficulty 256 bits? In the block header, it is. Yeah. I think I'm pretty sure. That's what we have documented. No.
Yeah, it's 64 bits, as if I'm recalling correctly. Yeah, the difficulty opcode may return up to 256 bits, as any other opcode, the EVM.
But you're saying in the block header, it's 64 bits.
Right.
Well, in the block header is RLP, right? So it could be any number, or is there a consensus
rule? Oh, really?
Is there a consensus rule that prevents it from being above 263?
I don't remember.
I don't think so. I mean, I'm going through my code.
I know that like
does block verification.
Yeah. I know that there's other things that have been set to 64-bit limits that like should be, but difficulty sounds like the sort of thing that would intuitively be risky to cap, right? Like, in even in the case of Bitcoin, like, you already need more than 2 to the 64 hashes to make a block. And, you know, if Ethereum was proof of work forever, we'd probably get there within a decade or two.
If that's the only thing holding us back, then we should probably investigate to find out if there, if the clients actually have that, in which case it may be a consensus issue, because it's possible that not all, like Geth, for example, has the nonce is 64 bits internally in Geth, but like consensus-wise, that is not a consensus rule. And so we do have known consensus issues, but they can't be reached. Difficulty is one that may be in a similar boat, but possibly reachable, which is obviously not a good thing.
Yeah, that's a good way of, that's a good thing to investigate in. Cool. So we probably can just, drop the whole endow into difficulty field, right?
Does that change the argument here? Let's say hypothetically that it is a 256-bit field and all clients support that. Does this seal the deal and we just say, okay, put Randao in there, we're done?
I'd say so. No, you mean we are done in the long term? Probably not.
It's
suboptimal.
Meaning we can put the full Randao mix into the difficulty field and we never have to change the opcode again.
Right. We can just change the way the Randao mix is transferred into the opcode. I mean,
yeah. Sure. Like, we might have another mechanism of getting it there later that's a little cleaner than having the consensus client send it with the request. But the gist is that opcode will just be the Randao mix from merge on.
Right. And also, it's going to be mixed into the block hash this way. But it doesn't matter much because block hash as a source of randomness won't be secure, as secure as it is now. Okay, anyway, we have 5 minutes to the next call. I think we should stop here. Thanks, everyone, for
dragging that up.
No problem. Thank you for chiming in. Okay, cool. So see you in 5 minutes. Thanks, everyone. Bye-bye.